We have every right to dream heroic dreams. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look.
My father left before I was born. I was basically brought up by my grandparents.
马克的家人多数都有过重的问题，尤其是马克的母亲。好不幸，他的母亲在控制体重的时候服用医生处方的减重药物上了瘾。
I can remember seeing her in the hospital and having a lot of things happen to her from drugs and what drugs can do to you. When I was 18 years old, she finally died from a drug overdose.
为了避免悲剧重演，马克远渡重洋到中国参加当地举办的草本植物研讨会。马克从中得到启发，深信草本植物营养学可以令到人安全有效地减重。然后马克马上着手寻找最优秀的生产商，制造自己信念中的产品。马克在比华利山开设了一间小小的办公室，同时是货仓亦是传销中心。然而马克在创业的首个月就赚到超过$23,000。康宝莱透过广告、宣传单张及逢星期二、四、六的传销机会会议渐渐为人所知。 Jerry Sutcliffe 是早期其中一个对康宝莱独具慧眼的人。
This ad just popped out at me. It said, Prisoner, are you tied to a desk? Do you hate punching a clock? And I looked at that ad. It was the, I tore it out. It was the only adI tore out. It was the only ad I responded to, and that ad Mark Hughes answered.
首年年底，康宝莱嘅营业额已高达$2,000,000。为咗扩充业务，马克将办公室同埋货仓搬到 Kovacs。不久之后，位于 Kovacs 嘅设备已经跟唔上康宝莱一日千里嘅发展，因此马克特地增加咗个货仓，以容纳惊人嘅订货数量。马克在同年的9月12号颁发首个生产奖金，为数$21,000。同年年中，康宝莱的营业额已增加至$10,000,000。康宝莱开始踏上国际舞台，将业务扩展至加拿大。Leslie Stanford 是其中一份子。1985年，美国食物及药物管理局在药品公司的压力之下，展开对美国本土健康食品工业的调查行动。今次的行动对于刚刚闯出名堂的康宝莱而言是莫大的打击。
There's going to be a whole lot more articles that are going to come out about this company, and they're not all going to be positive. Some are going to be very, very negative. Okay, they're going to take some bad shots at us. They're going to say some things are wrong with our products. They're going to say some things are wrong with some of the ingredients.
长达六日的聆讯里面，虽然康宝莱成为众矢之的，但是电视转播中我们可以看到马克对他的产品和梦想的信心一点都没有动摇。
And they should have been brought to this hearing instead of the so-called expert weight loss people that were here yesterday. I think if they're so expert in weight loss, why were they so fat?